Platformers are defined by how you move, from the exhilarating momentum in Super Meat Boy to the elegant combat of Hollow Knight or Madeline's fluid dash in Celeste. How the player moves can end up shaping an entire game, from combat and levels to art and even narrative, which is why having satisfying movement and responsive controls is vital to forming an incredible experience for the player. Hey, I'm Adam, and today I want to show you how you'd improve your platformer's feel and why it's worth the extra time. Before we start, all code examples shown were made in Unity, and links to see the full scripts can be seen in the description. So first, let's look at your most basic move, your run. Having a good run not only sets a great foundation for the rest of your character's movement, but also helps the player feel in constant control and fluid throughout each level. Your run can be broken down into three separate parts: acceleration, top speed, and deceleration. However, in many platformers, the character instantly goes to full speed as soon as you press forward. Immediately setting your character's velocity to their full speed lets you get a run working quickly, is simple to code for beginners, and feels quite responsive. However, having no acceleration or deceleration time can make your character feel quite stiff and robotic, and also later in development can make adding objects like conveyor belts or springs difficult and clunky to implement, something I found out while making my own game Cosmos. So instead, let's use forces. Using forces allows you to get much more fluid movement and takes advantage of Unity's physics system. But if you've ever used forces before, you know they can feel quite unresponsive and sloppy to control. So, what I like to do is in update, calculate the player's target speed using their movement input and multiplying this by the player's top speed. This finds the velocity that the player is trying to reach, which will be either their maximum speed or zero when they are trying to stop. Then we can use this to calculate the force needed to change our current velocity to our target one, or the speed difference. This is a great way to do movement, as it means that if we are moving in our desired direction already, we will apply much less force than say if we were trying to turn around our character. This also helps alleviate the sloppy feel of using physics, as it gets our character turning quickly and gets the player feeling smooth and fluid. Next, we multiply this difference by either an acceleration or deceleration value, so we can control how much force we want to apply to change our speed. After, we can raise it to a set power to further help the acceleration feel responsive and happen smoothly, before multiplying it by the sign to preserve the player's direction. Finally, we can apply this force using rigidbody.addForce and multiplying it by vector2.right so we only affect the x-axis. So that's the bulk of our movement done. This is a great system to do acceleration in loads of genres, and is really flexible to tweak to your own preferences. However, one issue that has emerged by using forces is that when the player tries to stop, it can feel quite slippy. This is amplified if you've already set the player's default friction to zero, which I'll talk more about later. So to fix this, we can add some artificial friction when the player is trying to stop. This works by checking first if our friction amount is greater than our current velocity. We use the smallest value to then apply a force against the current movement direction. This helps the player come to a stop much faster. Okay, so next, the jump. The simplest way to do this is to check if the player is grounded and pressing the jump button on the same frame. You can quickly do this by using an overlap box to check for the ground, and then using rigidbody.addForce again, however this time using the impulse force mode, to jump. But what if the player jumps right now, or just as they fall off a platform? To the player, it feels like the game hasn't registered their input, even though we know they weren't grounded. So what should we do about this? Well, one great solution is to implement what many have coined Coyote Time. To do this, we use two separate timers, one for when the player last pressed jump, and another for when they were last grounded. Then each frame, we check if both of these will mean true for a short duration, say a fifth and a tenth of a second. We'll reset each of these to our chosen value whenever the player jumps or is grounded. This is a really nice fix and feels great once added. Another way to make your jump feel nicer is to let the player perform a jump cut. This allows them to control their jump height by holding the jump button longer and adds even more depth to the movement. You see this in nearly every platformer, from Super Mario Bros. To Hollow Knight. It's super easy to implement and feels great to use. To add this, we check if the player has released the jump button, and then, if this is true, reduce their current velocity by a multiplier. Usually a half is a good starting value. As well as a jump cut, Another common feature found on most platformers is extra fall gravity. Having a higher gravity after reaching the peak of your jump really helps your jump feel more bouncy and responsive. Again, this can be implemented super quickly by adjusting a rigid body's gravity scale when falling. So, that's pretty much everything. To show the potential of the system, here are some examples I've made replicating some popular platformers. Now for a few final quickfire tips and tricks. First, within the player game object, using a circle collider helps fix issues where the player gets stuck on the ground, especially when using tile maps. Second, applying a 2D physics material to the player stops them from getting stuck on walls or the sides of platforms. Third, increasing gravity in your project settings helps if your platformer is feeling too floaty. I generally use about negative 30. And finally, setting the rigid body to continuous, never sleep, and interpolate helps improve collision detection and player physics. So that's everything for today. Thanks so much for watching. This is my first game design slash tutorial style video, so I hope you enjoyed it. I'd like to make more stuff like this in the future, tackling game design tips and tricks, dev logs on projects I'm working on, and even maybe some game design breakdowns. So if you have any ideas or suggestions, please feel free to let me know. My plan for this channel is to create a community of people interested in talking about game design, as well as a space for us to share our creations with each other. And on that note, I'll see you in the next one. Have a great day.